The sound is good. All right. So Jos gave you a pretty good introduction to serverless and the serverless network framework. So I will slightly go outside of those serverless boundaries to show you an example of hybrid serverless architecture. But beforehand, I would like to know by show of hands, how many of you are using AWS? Okay, how many of you are using serverless Lambda and what we just saw? All right, and how many of you are using CloudFormation, like writing CloudFormation? All right. So I will go quickly because yours did already a good overview. So I will just introduce you what are the limitations of Lambda. So now you know them already, but I just have to go through it. How to counter those limitations, therefore the hybrid solution. And after I will show you a demo. So I will try to show you more code and live demos than just talking, and because without proper example, it's hard to figure out. I don't think I will have time to deploy properly from scratch. If we have some, I can show you. But basically, the demo I will show you has already everything deployed and so on. But I will go through it later. So the limitations are basically the memory. So if you want to execute basically image processing, you might have an issue. Audio processing, you might have an issue. The CPU is not really clear. How much CPU do you have? Basically, it could be an issue also if you are really picky about your specification. The disk space as well. And furthermore, you only have access to the slash temp, which is already great, but you may have the use of other directory in your file system. The duration, which is 5 minutes. So for some processes, 5 minutes is still long, but it could be short, especially if you are processing video, for example. So you may have some issues for that until AWS increase all those specifications. But for now, that's, I would say, the current boundaries. So as I said, it's maybe not suitable for long-running processes such as image, audio, video. Maybe you need specific CPU and memory. Maybe also you need some third-party libraries, such as why not FFmpeg to process your video and images, which are not provided by Lambda itself. They used to provide Image Magic, but they don't do anymore. So you need to kind of install your own tools if you want. So depending on the third party you use, it might increase the size of your package. And also it implies as bigger is the package, meaning the code you push to your Lambda, in theory, longer is the cold start. You remember this cold start, like roughly 50 milliseconds guarantee. But yeah, it will be too big and then you cannot. So you need to find a way to use your code in a serverless ecosystem, and maybe you want a specific OS. So basically, for now, I would say it run. I don't know exactly what they are running, but it's like Linux, Unix style. There is obviously a solution. I forgot to ask who is using Lambda on production. No one. Perfect. And who is using ECS on production? Perfect. Okay, so I will maybe overview of all those services and way it works, and after maybe I will maybe go into the Q&A. It will be maybe more interesting for you. So what I show you here is basically a type of hybrid architecture you may think about. So what you see in front of the user is what you call in AWS the API gateway. basically in my architecture, I put it as an example, but I will not deploy it. It's not deployed. So basically, my demo start at the Lambda level. So this Lambda, we will see what it's used for. Then this Lambda will use SQS queue. It's basically very suitable for job queue. So my demo is more likely you have a job queue application backend, let's say. And then the hybrid things come from the fact that you will run a cluster, ECS cluster, meaning EC2 behind the scene. And behind the scene, you have a Docker container. So after, we will see how we use this in a serverless spirit, let's say. And then you have a dead letter queue, but this goes with SQS. So basically, to summarize, the hybrid comes from the fact that you are using an ECS cluster, which is not serverless, because you need to take care of this cluster. I will show you via the code, more likely, how you do it. Basically, you will do it with auto-scaling group, meaning it's kind of a service to help you to scale your instances, your cluster, according to the workload you have. And so you have this Lambda, which will kind of interact with this, I would say, old-fashioned way to design a service. So I will go straight into the code. So I think you can see properly, right? Is it big enough for everyone? So as Jos introduced you, I will use a serverless framework, but I will not run any command line or any, because it can be a bit long. So basically, it's an example of architecture, I mean, in terms of project style. So you will notice a Docker file. This will be useful for the ECS cluster, basically. The functions is what the Lambda, finally. What the Lambda is under functions. So basically, you remember this handler, right? So this will run what you saw in the graphic, this Lambda in front of the user, basically. And then you will have a worker. The worker is deployed in the container, the Docker file. So this worker will run in the ECS cluster to take the workload. What this worker is doing is polling the queue, this SQS queue I was talking about in the architecture. So you have this function which takes the workload. I will go into detail maybe a bit later. Then you have this cluster. So this function will post into the queue, obviously. The cluster will listen to the queue, poll the queue, get the job, and after you can imagine other events. So basically, the idea is to have this cluster as a super Lambda, and after from there, you can keep going as a serverless. So you start with a serverless function, which can be accessed by an API gateway. So you push an event to this Lambda function. This Lambda function, because it's serverless, you can scale easier than having as a front-end a pool of EC2, for example. So whatever workload you have, you are sure that you can store in the SQS queue. So whatever the number of users, for example, or the number of video to treat or whatever, Lambda will guarantee you that you can still store in the SQS queue. That's why you are serverless at that moment. Then the ECS cluster will take over by polling the queue and do the job. This is actually the main point where you will be slow or whatever, but the load is completely outside of this scope. It doesn't care about if you have a lot of your. The Lambda is here for you to store in the SQS queue, then the ECS will do the job, and then after you can imagine using the API AWS SDK to trigger other events. You could trigger a Lambda function from your ECS cluster using the SDK, like here, you know, I use in JavaScript the SQS, which actually is the SWS SDK, all right? So I just use the SQS SDK to pull in my JavaScript code. So you could imagine the same to post an event. Because as you saw previously in the presentation, everything will be based on event. So you could imagine taking over after the ECS cluster. You could post the image process in an S3 with the SDK. So once the image is on S3, you can imagine having other events triggering other lambdas. So that's for the architecture. And just because it will not be interesting otherwise, I will run a bit of C++ in my worker. So it's just a hello world kind of. It will just print what. So basically, it will take the event from the lambda. It will post into the queue. The cluster listens to the queue, run the worker. The worker will spawn with Node.js a native app. Let's call it like this. So it could be FFmpeg. It was just to show you that you can run native app. Once it's finished, take the output and display basically what is the number of attendees of this meetup, which I will actually do dynamically. But this will be output in the logs, nothing much. CloudWatch logs for the one who knows. So the great thing as well is like Lambda function will log everything in the CloudWatch by default, CloudWatch logs. In that particular case for the EC2 cluster, I did create the log to show you this. So I did create the log groups. So I will show you. So basically, if I go before this, if you see the serverless.yml, it should be familiar to you right now. There is some custom variable directly linked to the serverless framework itself. So this is not CloudFormation, it's just a YML. You have your environment variable that will be passed to the Lambda function itself as environment variable. You have the IAM role statements, which were mentioned previously. So it will grant the access to your resource from your Lambda. So basically, if I go to the iam.yml, which is just here, you see that it just described with an iam role what is supposed to be. So this Lambda is supposed to read and write into a queue, as because it's a front. And is supposed to also trigger the worker in the ECS. So basically, how the worker will pull the queue, basically the ECS is running nothing, it's just the instances, so you will pay for the EC2, but as soon as there is a work to be done and something in the queue, the Lambda will at the same time spawn, kind of tell the ECS to run the task, to run the worker. I hope it's kind of clear. So I summarize. You have a Lambda receiving a job. It goes into the queue. Once it's in the queue, it runs with the SDK. It says, hey, I will run this task. And AWS does a job for you to know which cluster and so on. Then the worker takes over and output the result. So if I go a bit So you see the function here, the service, which is just the Lambda function. And then after I declare my CloudFormation. So because it's hybrid, the serverless framework will not create the ECS for you, will not create the whatever you need, the auto-scaling group. So this, you need a custom CloudFormation. And for that, they provide you the way to add your own CloudFormation. So what they will do is they will just amend their own generated CloudFormation template and put your resources. So the heavy lifting of declaring the Lambda function and so on is still done by the serverless framework. But what you have to do manually is to write your CloudFormation template anyway. So basically, you just declare the what kind of instance you have the right to use in your cluster with this famous map array of instance type image from the region. I declare my queue, which I name serverless queue. The dead letter is by default generated by AWS. I declare the ECR repository, which is it's kind of Docker hub. You will store your container in this repository, which is after used for the ECS cluster to pull the image, run it in the cluster. Then you declare VPC, it's mandatory. VPC is kind of internal network so that your cluster is kind of isolated from the outside. VPC configuration is quite big. Then I have the security group, which is mandatory for the EC2 running in the cluster. For the one running EC2, it should be kind of familiar to you, EC2 role as well. I just go through the template just to show you what it will look like, actually. Then you have to declare in the role what your worker has the right to access to as well, meaning the EC2 has the right to access the log, because I had to create the log myself to log what is outputted by the ECS, which is transparent, which is completely seamless with Lambda, because they will log for you whatever they need to log, so you just have to parse the log, it's easy. In that case, I still have to create from scratch, so it will be under the name ECS worker and the name of my stack. Pull, ECS create cluster, everything. I move forward, the logs, ECS cluster, I declare my cluster. I declare my task definition. This is a bit more interesting because it's kind of what Lambda will do. It's like I tell the cluster to run worker, it spawns the worker down, it shut down. So it's not an ECS running a service. There is two types of services in ECS that you can run. You can run it as a task or you can run it as a service, meaning the service will run all the time. So if you have a memory leak, maybe it's not great. And the task will run and stop when it's finished, when there is an exit, whatever. So that's what I want, actually. I want something which is running in the cluster in ECS, in EC2, but I don't want it to run forever. So in my case, it's a node application. I will show you after, but that's basically it. So it's kind of simulating a Lambda behavior. So I run the task when I have a job in the queue, basically. I mean, this task is triggered by the Lambda as soon as the job has been posted in the queue, which is slightly different. And then the container instance, then the auto-scaling group, because in that case, it's important also to be workload robust, meaning you still need to scale this ECS, because otherwise, if you have 30,000 Lambdas posting in the queue and running tasks, so meaning 30,000 tasks, basically, task definition triggered. If you have a small instance, small cluster, you will not sustain the load. So basically, it's always important to have this auto-scaling group so that you will spawn more instances running your workers. So it's the basic of a cluster, basically. So you still need this auto-scaling group, which will be scaled according to the number of just let me see. Okay, so yeah, I will start with one and it goes up to two if a job is in the queue for too long. If the queue, the SQS queue start to pile too much jobs, then it will auto-scale. And then the output, just to output in the CloudFormation things, the value. So I will show you how it looks like. So basically, So this is what you just saw as a code. This is just the output, all right? So I have my task definition, my queue, my cluster, everything is set up. So basically, I will just go straight to the demo. So here you see the function. This is the one deployed here. So I will test directly through the AWS console, but you could trigger in with whatever event you want. Basically, a good overview of event is just like you can basically all of that is event. So I will not go through the list, but you can imagine S3, Dynamo Stream, what has been shown basically in the previous talk. So here I will take for example this hello world, but I will not be interested in this. I will rather go to here and here. And if there is no demo effect, it should work. So what this is replied back by the lambda. So what lambda tell me, basically, I ask the lambda to return me the fact that the task has been properly triggered. Yeah, you see here, I just ask the lambda. So this is the lambda function. I just ask the lambda to enqueue the job, to spawn the task in the ECS cluster, and to return me back the ECS response. So if I go to my CloudWatch, so this is my custom CloudWatch that I had to write down in the CloudFormation. This is a default CloudWatch generated by Lambda itself with serverless framework, meaning. So serverless framework like is really nice for you, so you don't have to take care of all those heavy lifting. So the logs is, I don't log anything, I think. Yeah, I don't log anything. So what you have is just the very basic logs that AWS Lambda gives you. Basically the duration, the build duration, and the memory size that it was used. The memory size configure and the memory size used. Basically here you see that it's quite high because first it was cold start and then it waits for the ECS to reply back that, okay, the task is running. If I go to the ECS worker, so this is a message that I sent as here, you see, 300. Here, just so this is replied back by the C++ application, which could be image processing. So basically, I spawn in JavaScript my C++ app. I wait for the return. When the promise return, I just display a console log of the number of attendees. So just so it's basically here, this chunk of code. And it returns you the job. Once the job is done, the worker will call the SDK to just remove it from the queue so that it just keep going. And I think I put 6 seconds of polling with the SDK. When it's finished, basically you just go back to the poll queue. It will wait 6 seconds, and this is automatically done by the SDK. You don't really need to care of. So just for the demo, you could say that we are 310. Save. And so the task has been run. It will take a bit of time, you see, to display the log. So for now, it will be empty. Up, and now it appears. So it was maybe slightly faster. And so here, even if the cluster tells me that there is not enough memory, because in my task definition, I say like, for a container to run, you give this amount of memory, otherwise you don't run it. It's not a big deal, because it will still be in the queue by the lambda, and it will be taken over by the worker, since it's polling. So even if the task cannot be launched, meaning the worker cannot be triggered directly. The worker just finishing the previous task will take over the next task. So basically, even if the event trigger is lost, since it's a polling process, it's fine. So I will just, if you trigger, you know, you will see that resource memory, meaning the ECS tells me that it cannot run more container, but it doesn't mean that the task is lost. Proof is, I don't know how many times I did, but let's say, you see, you have this, basically all the event has been processed because anyway it's polling. So first time the task was triggered, the second time it could not be triggered, but it's still in the queue. So when the first task just finished, it just take over. And if there is no task anymore, everything shut down until the next time. Here, if I do it again, I will have like, okay, I have enough memory. Then I do it again. Ah, no, I don't have enough memory because I took a small instance because I didn't want to pay too much. So that's why. And so you have all your logs here. And this just tell me it's me. I choose to send just like the queue is empty. My job is done. And you see that it was 310. So this is just to show you that you could eventually imagine that it's video processing. When you finish, goes S3, takes, and so on. So I think I did pretty much everything around the demo. There is something I can try to show you, is the fact that I spawned the worker or not. For that, just to show you for real, yes, it should be this, because I don't remember the DNS. Okay, so now I'm connected to my ECS cluster, right? So basically, I have only one instance. So I'm connected to one instance of my cluster. It's an EC2 instance. If I do, I think.
I'm sorry, you can write using a serverless and deploy to your instance, is
it? This is, I have both actually. I deploy my function and I deploy the part of code in ECS, which is a worker. So I will just, all right, so. Okay, should work like this. It's a bit improvised. Okay, so this is my Lambda function. Okay, so when I will click test, I just send the event through the AWS that, okay, trigger this function with this payload. And the function knows that after, okay, I receive an event. What I have to do, I have to enqueue in the SQS and I have to trigger the task. Because there is no way from the SQS doesn't send an event to any services. So that's why I trigger the task manually. Even if you are pure Lambda, there is no way yet to trigger Lambda through the SQS queue. Right? So it's not because you receive a job in the queue that other services will be aware. You need a way to trigger them. That's the way, by using the SDK. So if I do that, and I do that, please. Yes, so you see the worker here triggered. So I trigger as many as needed and then it shut down. So basically, it's kind of Lambda because even if I have a memory leak in my worker, I don't really care because I know that I don't need to kind of manually kill my instance or go to the instance, connect to the ECS agent and restart it or whatever. I just don't really care. So if I can do it again normally. So here I did many times. So the worker will stay up. Here maybe there is two workers run, but it will be up until the task is very teeny tiny, so it's very fast, but you could imagine it running, just shutting down. So yeah, it's kind of Lambda, but actually, in this configuration, you get access to its ECS instance. So basically, you have all the benefits. And if you want to see the ECS logs, it's in here. I mean, after it's very classic, but that's oops. So here it shows you that the task change event, blah blah, I need to run the containers, and if you read the log, you will see up shutdown, then running, shutdown, running, shutdown. So that's basically it for the demo. And then maybe we, if you have some question from here, some basic, maybe a misunderstanding, because I know
what it's... What
is the Docker file? The Docker file is just to build, because you are in ECS, so you need to run a container. Container is basically, in my case, I choose Docker, and you need a Docker file to build the... how much time do we have? Okay, now I will show you just the Docker file. After, I can try a live demo of pushing it to the cloud. at least you will have seen it working. If it fails after, you can just... So this is just a Docker file, and there is nothing really. I just took a Ubuntu instance, which could be, if you have your own C++ code, basically what I'm doing is I put everything. It's 3.1, but basically what it just contains, what it should contain only, is a worker and the binaries, this C++ app, or even third party, or you can also install directly if you run it from your own image with FFmpeg already installed. And anyway, it's just a Docker file that will go to the ECS, to the ECR, the repository. It's actually like that. So basically it's like a Docker hub, huh? You just store in your repository your image. Basically I tell the task to always run the latest image. After, you can choose what kind of image you want, but that's the basic. As soon as the task is triggered, it will run the container, which is stored as an image here. The cluster, as you can see, there is one EC2 instance. And the task definition I was talking about, which is defining the amount of memory, the container, the minimum of memory required for the container to run, the amount of CPU. It's kind of Docker Compose somehow. And it's also I think there is some detail. Yeah, you see, you just, as well, you can map, as every Docker, you can map the local folder, which here I map the temp, but since I'm in EC2 right now, I could map any kind of volume I want. If I have to store a big video, temporary. Maybe other question. So basically in that particular case, if I had to do it manually, I can show you at least some commands maybe. Maybe I will do the demo. Okay, I will do the demo. for that, I will have to delete manually some stuff. It will be quick, normally. And you close your eyes because it's my private account. no, it should be quick if internet wants to be quick. All right, I delete the bucket. By the way, what is the best practice?
Does serverless have a destroy kind of a function where it can destroy the resources that it created, something similar to Terraform?
There's a serverless remove command, but it just be the reverse of deploy.
Okay.
Yeah, so I will delete my stack. It should be before that. Sorry, I will delete that, because CloudFormation will not be happy. So CloudFormation is really nice because they protect you to do some bad thing. And yes, I will delete the stack. Should be fairly easy and fast. So once it's done, I can redeploy, obviously, otherwise it will conflict. No, this is really manual. Normally you go to a CI and all those stuff. Basically, the benefit of CloudFormation is you just update your CloudFormation, you push. Because I want to show you from scratch how it goes. After, I can relaunch if you want, but I just wanted to show for the one who are not get used to it, how it goes from scratch. So normally it should be almost done, yeah. But basically when you update a CloudFormation, it will just take the diff, and now AWS will be smart enough to just update your stack. So if you update your autoscaling group rules, it will just be seamless. Sorry, it's maybe a bit slower.
When I saw something when you said that you store the ECS container, or it's stored when you receive a message from the queue?
It's slightly different. It's the lambdas trigger the worker. First, it stores into the queue. Then it triggers the worker, because as I was saying, there is no way yet to trigger something from an SQS queue directly. It's not a push, it's a pull system. So basically, because of that, I need to trigger the puller. All right, the puller, the worker is in the ECS. I don't want my worker to be running all the time to avoid any kind of memory leak or whatever. So for that, as soon as the Lambda receives a message, whatever the workload, it's stored in SQS, then it triggers the ECS. If the ECS cannot be triggered, it's not a big deal, it's still in the SQS. And the currently running worker will, yeah.
In that case, you just have an event, and in this event stored container, that is, you don't need ECS.
No, there is no event. That's why it's hybrid. You start from Lambda, which is take any event you want. It could be an HTTP. For example, we just take this. Takes more time to delete. Sorry. If you see this, here you can have any kind of event you want. It could start from an S3. Let's say I uploaded an image. Imagine an S3 bucket in front of the Lambda, right? The event is triggered. The Lambda is listening to this event. What does the Lambda? Takes the job. Takes the S3 URL of your image, the path, the object key, store it in the SQS, so you store this, because you have a limited amount of data that you can store in an SQS queue as well, so the goal is to store the minimum possible. So what you need is just the object key, and maybe the bucket name. And at the same time, you trigger the ECS task, which is just a container, all right? You have a cluster, you say, okay, just trigger this. What is this? This is just something listening to the queue. So since you store the job already, when you spawn it, it's already ready. So the worker will just take the job. If the queue is empty, it will just shut down, as you saw with the grep, you know? The worker was spawning, shutting down. So it's kind of a way to limit memory leak or whatever. So, but you obviously you have this ECS cluster, which supposed to run a container. But what you want is this container to just shut down when there is nothing to do. Because if you have a huge workload and you have a memory leak, you will have your ECS cluster, which is just hanging forever. So your queue will pile. You can the autoscale will scale more with more EC2. But if all those EC2 are hanging as well, you are basically in a bad situation. Sorry? Because you don't have the memory at the moment you want to trigger it. But if you don't have enough memory, it means a worker is already in use. After you can, like, imagine a container. Imagine in your instance, you say, I want to run two containers. In this instance, all right? The Lambda, when it triggers a container, let's call about container and not worker. You have a container which is supposed to be triggered. Then the Lambda receives another event. You have two containers running now, two workers. Then there is other events coming. The Lambda store in SQS and send the event, like trigger another container. But the cluster reply, I can't. But it's not a big deal, because there is already those containers running, so that when they just finished, they just take more job from the queue.
How can you configure that for the cluster, how many image you can?
Via the task definition.
Was it in the cloud formation?
Yes, yes, it was in the cloud formation. The cloud formation, yeah. You see, it was this. So basically, you declared your the CPU. It's like a CPU unit. Basically, it's half of the total available in an EC2. I mean, I go very in the detail. It depends what is your knowledge in the. But basically, the task definition is the boundaries to the what the containers are allowed to do.
So the instance, or it just loaded an instance for you with this container?
Yeah. So, imagine the instance is a big server running containers. Those containers, they run from this task definition. They are allowed to run according to this task definition. All right? So imagine you have a big box with smaller box. Those smaller boxes are running if there is a task or not. So I think I will not have too much time to run it, but let's say just to finish, just before, maybe, I will just show you. Sorry? Ah, yeah. Go ahead for the question, because it's more interesting.
All right. So given the way you've structured this, right, you're assuming that the ECS would return the job within 5 minutes, right?
No.
Can you look at your Lambda function, please?
Yes.
Initial function and the function directory, the functions folder?
Yep.
Functions folder?
Yep.
Oh, no, sorry. I guess that's not in there.
No, that's why the hybrid is confusing, because you think you are in Lambda, but you are not anymore.
No, because like in Lambda, you're called, you know, you're basically dispatched to queue.
Exactly.
But you're waiting for the ECS
to tell me that it has been triggered, but the ECS reply back, as you saw, it's the ECS agent will reply me back directly if there is not enough memory or whatever.
Right.
Because it's your scheduler. The ECS is your Kubernetes or...
Yeah, no, I understand that, but you're triggering it, so you're triggering the Lambda, you know, for the Lambda function, you're triggering it.
Exactly.
And then you're waiting for ECS to give you a reply.
Yeah, but this is a snap, because the ECS agent knows if it can or not. So it's like, I ask you to do something, you tell me no, okay.
No, it says that it can. Like, let's assume that it can, but you're processing a very, very big video file.
But the concept is not to wait for a job. This goes after. So you go from the Lambda, you have the worker.
Okay.
It does a job, the Lambda doesn't care. The Lambda doesn't wait for the result of the job, but just wait for the result of the job has been taken care of somehow.
Ah, okay. Right.
Like, I know that I told you that you had a job to do, that's for sure.
Right.
If somehow it's even not true, it's still in the queue. If somehow. So basically, after when you finish, the job is over, your next move would be, as I said, to use the SDK to trigger another resources,
right.
Meaning you could even trigger another task in another cluster,
right.
Or you could just store in S3, and from S3 you go back to your serverless architecture.
That makes sense, because like a Lambda function would kill itself. Like
exactly, it's timeout. So basically, one of the limitations, by the way, of Lambda is that if it's timeout, you don't know that it timeout. There is no obvious way to, there is no CloudWatch alarm, or there is no such thing yet. So the only way for you to be aware of timeout is to tell the function that your process is supposed to take this amount of time. Like you say, I want this to take 4 minutes. If the function timeout, you will timeout, the goal is to put a timeout as long as your task is supposed to run. So you can your own task will just know, I timed out. But you don't trust the timeout of the function itself. It's more your code will time out because you say, okay, I have to run like a HTTP response or whatever. I want to time out my HTTP response if it takes more than 10 seconds. Because if you wait for the 30, for the 5 minutes or plus to time out, basically, if you will never know that you're something timeout before. Like, so it's better to timeout first by yourself, And so you don't rely on those because you don't have easy way to know. Like if you have a strange bug appearing, it may take a bit of time to know that you timed out. Like it's not obvious. But for that, you have a CloudWatch. If you run some metrics, if you go to the CloudWatch dashboard after, you can see the average amount of time the function is running. And obviously, if you see that a lot run until 5 minutes or less, I mean, you define the timeout of the function as well. It's like you can say timeout in 10 milliseconds. That's what I think I did. Yeah, you know, here I time out in 10 seconds because I know it's overkill because I know my job is a few milliseconds. But the goal is you time out before the lambda timeout itself. Right. So that's, yeah, if in your log you see that the duration of your function are always 5 minutes because you didn't put any timeout, basically you put default. Basically, default is 5 minutes. Then you have a guess that your function timeout because they reach the maximum and after your stuff is still not good. So meaning you may timeout. Then you may force a timeout to be sure that now you can inspect the log because once it timeout, even if you do a stack trace or whatever, you will have nothing. It just so better to timeout yourself. Yes, that's one of the tricky parts of Lambda, especially when you run in production. You need to, it forces you to, basically it's just part of best practice. You should always be knowing what you are doing. So if you should time out, you should know that you want to time out. Your task is supposed to take this amount of milliseconds or seconds. And because it's also good for your cost, because if you'd say, oh, I have tasks to do, but I don't know how much it takes, so let's just oversize our cluster or over. You should always know kind of the specification. If you go over, then you try to optimize your application, or you slightly increase your. You can do that with the CloudWatch alarms, whatever. I'm not sure it's possible to dynamically modify the timeout of a function. I never did, but maybe there is some ways. As you will scale a dynamo, for example, with the capacity. Other question. Hope it was kind of clear. But yeah, okay, thank you.